Hi, physical geography students. In this video, we continue our review of Chapter 7 on atmospheric disturbances. Specifically, we're looking at mid-latitude cyclones in this video, which are very important for our overall understanding of weather, particularly in the United States, between 30 and 60 degrees latitude, where probably most of us taking this class reside. So what is a mid-latitude cyclone? I know there's a lot of text here. Don't worry about that too much. You can go back into the online lecture on Chapter 7 if you need to review the notes. But I just want to explain what we're seeing here. The mid-latitude cyclone is a migratory low-pressure system, and cyclone is simply another word for low pressure. It could also be called a depression or a wave cyclone, and it's found almost entirely within the band of westerly winds. If you recall the global wind belts, 30 to 60 degrees north and south is the zone of the westerlies, where winds are coming out of the west, moving toward the east, and those winds will push along the mid-latitude cyclone. So when you think of California getting a storm, you know that it's going to move in this direction, and then maybe in a couple days, Texas will have that storm as it continues its movement. The mid-latitude cyclone is about 1,000 miles in diameter, so that's quite a lot of the United States. And it has a low surface pressure with converging surface winds. So you'll notice that you have cold air that spins out of the high pressure from the northwest, moving toward that low. And then you have warm air moving up from the south, and all of this is moving in that counterclockwise direction that we expect with a low pressure system. And this frontal lifting, the cold air mass meeting the warm, will produce that precipitation. This diagram here is a cross-section of the mid-latitude cyclone, so imagine that you're pivoting this so that you're looking at it from the side rather than looking down, and you have your cold air mass. This, as we talked about fronts, is going to push that warm air up, creating the more greater amounts of precipitation, more violent and blustery weather. And here you just have the warm air mass as that cold front moves rapidly. It's going to eventually overtake that warm front. The warm front moving more slowly. You still have precipitation possibly along this band, but it's going to be more of the gradual precipitation and less of it. So when you have the passing of that cold front, here's your mid-latitude cyclone on a satellite image. Here's the center of that low. It looks like a hurricane, doesn't it? And that's because a hurricane is a form of a cyclone. But in this case, it doesn't meet the criteria of a hurricane. As that mid-latitude cyclone passes, you're going to see, and the cold front passes, you're going to see a sharp decrease in temperature. Winds that were initially from the south shift to coming from the north and the northwest. After the front passes, the pressure is going to fall as the front approaches. You may recall that I've asked you when you did your weather assignment to look at pressure. Is it falling? Is it rising? That will tell us something about whether precipitation is likely. It makes sense that the pressure is going to fall as the mid-latitude cyclone moves in, as this front approaches, because that warm air is being pushed up, so you have less pressure at the surface. And then clouds replace the clear skies along this frontal boundary here. I know this is scrunched up here a little bit on your screen. I can't get it to, oh, maybe I can get it to go a little bit wider. The life cycle of a mid-latitude cyclone is approximately 3 to 10 days. from maturity to dissipation. So here you have a diagram that shows you on day one, you have the cold air mass and the warm air mass where you have a stationary front. And as it progresses, you get more of this distinct cold front and warm front. The cold front is going to move more quickly, so it's going to overtake the warm front until you have an occluded front. And once the whole thing becomes occluded, then the storm will dissipate. So that here, this only took 3 days for the entire storm to cross the United States. So here you see a diagram again of how this looks three-dimensionally, where you have the winds, the jet stream at the upper level, but your surface winds, you have the anticyclonic flow, the air spinning out of, diverging out of the high pressure toward the low pressure, because air always moves from high to low, and that's going to feed in this cold front here, whereas you had warm air coming up from that maritime tropical source region, and you will get that cyclonic flow beginning. Move this back down here, and you see at the upper level, you have winds spinning into the high and diverging out, winds spinning into the low, and then spinning out back into the high. So with the occlusion, the storm ultimately dissipates when that cold front overtakes that warm front. And this will explain so much of why we experience stormy weather here in the United States. But you have to factor in so many things, like we talked about the Rossby waves. When you look at that meridional flow, like we talked about the jet stream here, in an ideal situation, it would be moving just from west to east. But then you add the different rates of insolation where the sun is overhead in different areas at different times of the year, and you'll get some of that meridional flow of the jet stream. Like, let's say you might get an Arctic blast and it will push some of this colder air further down, where you have this warmer air coming up, and that can generate your mid-latitude cyclone as well. So very important for our understanding here, particularly when we look at why do we have hurricanes in the Atlantic Ocean, in the area of the Caribbean, where you have that warm air mixed with warm seawater and so forth that you looked at in Chapter 7. So understanding fronts, mid-latitude cyclones, air masses, source regions, all of this hopefully is coming together for you a little bit now to give you a basic understanding of atmospheric disturbances.